So here's how the Venn diagram would look like. So this is the substrate, and remember I told you there are two dielectrics. There's this tunnel dielectric, and this is your thicker dielectric or your interpoly dielectric. Sometimes it's also called as the blocking dielectric. So when you apply a program, when you program a cell, you apply a very high voltage on your control gate. So applying high voltage means it comes down on this band diagram. And you get a very large amount of tunnel current in, and you get a less amount of tunnel current out. The reverse happens when you want to erase the cell. So when you erase the cell, you typically already have electrons stored. And you apply a negative voltage on your control gate, so it pushes it up. And that essentially kicks out these electrons from your floating gate. The other way is also that holes come from your substrate into your floating gate. Both are the same effect. They essentially remove or negate the electrons present in your control gate. So this is, you know, the simple equation that your charge is essentially just build up integration of these different currents tunneling in and out. And this is how a typical transient of threshold voltage looks like. So if you apply a fixed gate voltage, your charge builds up over time, and either you can achieve a high VT depending upon whether you're programming it, or you can achieve a negative VT if you're trying to erase it. And this difference between your program and erase VT is your total program window. A thing I would recommend you to go home and try is, you know, take your flash drive, your USB drive, and take a 1 gigabyte file and just copy it into it and read the rate at which it's writing into it, and then copy it back to your hard drive and then read the rate at which it, or count either the time, or many a time your operating system also displays the rate at which it's transferring. And you'll find that it's much faster to read as compared to write into this flash drive. Also, you know, when you erase it, it actually erases it instantly because it's just changing it from the file system, but usually it's very time consuming to erase your flash as well. Let's see. So this top dielectric, that is IPD, could either be just a single dielectric, that is just an oxide, or it could be multiple layers. And typically what people use is ONO. And the reason they use ONO is you want a higher dielectric constant, and nitride has a higher dielectric constant than oxide, so that's why it's ONO. So when you have programmed your cell, what you want to do is you remove the voltage you apply on your gate, so this term goes to zero, and this is negative charge, so that develops a negative voltage on your floating gate. Negative voltage means it rises up in this band diagram. And you want to, at this particular state, you want to retain your state of your cell. And typical specs range between 10 years to 1 year. But if you have an iPad and you downloaded music, you don't want it to disappear the next year you turn your device on. So you want at least a few years of retention. And so what is needed is that at this particular voltage, which is a couple of volts, you want your tunneling current to be very high. So this tunneling current could be both across your tunnel oxide and both across your interpoly dielectric. And that interpoly dielectric could just be either one oxide or it could be this ONO. And remember, nitride has a lower band gap as compared to oxide. So if I just use nitride, I get a higher tunneling current out. So I use a composite dielectric to essentially give me a better retention, or even to, when I'm programming it, to block these electrons from leaking out. So don't worry, we will put a lot of these band structure in your problem set too, so you can practice with these, or how does it look when it program erase. The other thing which is important is for your flash memory is your endurance or your cycling. So what it means is that how many times you can keep on reading and writing your cell. So what happens is that initially you have this large program erase window between your program threshold voltage and erase threshold voltage. But over time, if you keep on cycling it, that is, if you keep on programming and erasing it, it starts to close. And the reason why it happens is because you get between in your tunnel dielectric, you tend to trap these electrons. They were trying to grow from your channel to your floating gate, but over the period of time, there's build up some trap charge in your tunnel dielectric, and that pushes your erase VT higher because you have trap charge in your tunnel dielectric. At the same time, they prevent electrons from tunneling to your floating gate. So the total charge your floating gate can store goes down. So your program state goes down, your erase state goes up. And that's also called as window closure. And remember this, you know, these materials were not meant for conducting current. They were, God made them to be insulator, but we are, you know, playing with their properties and trying to flow current in and out, and they don't really tend to like it, and they degrade over time, right? So another thing which happens is that if you keep on tunneling current in and out of your device, you get this phenomenon which is known as stress-induced leakage current. So you get multiple of these traps placed very close to each other. And now, since you know there's not just one of them, but they have formed a gang and there are many of them, they can combine together and give you a tunneling path for current. So what happens in your low voltage state, you were supposed to get really this dashed line low current, but you tend to get this higher current. And that's really bad for retention, because when we are retaining the state, as I described you, we are floating gates develops a potential which is, you know, somewhere in this range. And this stress-induced leakage really tends to limit your retention time. So this is described over here. So when for my retention state, I really want a low floor for my tunneling current. But as I get more and more of this stress-induced leakage, this current in the low voltage state goes up. And that tends to limit my retention requirement. So I'm no longer able to meet that 10 years of retention requirement. All right, so this is another band diagram showing that. So if you, initially if you were, you hadn't done any cycling, you had a very good cell, you will have only limited number of tunneling paths. Versus if you cycle your cell, or if you program erase it, say 1,000 times, you get these trap states in your dielectric, and that tends to give you this additional component, which is trap-assisted tunneling, or also silk, and then that tends to limit the amount of time you can store your charge. So the last concept I want to cover is the multi-level cell operation. So remember, your threshold voltage is just linearly related to your charge. So why not store more than one state? So this is my window, that is, this is my zero state, this is my program state. Then I think, you know, I have this large window, why can't I fit multiple cells between them? And that's exactly what people did. So instead of storing one bit, if you want to store two bits, you essentially need four of these levels. So people developed, you know, you can store four different amount of charge, and based upon that you get four of these levels, and you can essentially store two bits in the same cell. And that's what's called as multi-level cell. And people, there are cells available in the market which are three level per cell, also called as TLC. So for TLC, you'll need 2^3 or 8 levels. And believe it or not, there are cells available which store 4 bits per cell as well. So for 4 bits in one cell, you'll need 16 of these levels. And these levels have to be separated. And this is not just one level, it's a distribution. So these distribution needs to be well separated from each other. They don't need to close when you cycle the cell. And that's, but still it's doable and people do it. So this really started in 1992 and 1997 was when the first multi-level cell was shipped, and actually most of your iPads and your iPhone contain a MLC device. It's not a one-level cell. And the downside is that since you have multiple of your these levels, your signal to noise ratio decreases. And also it becomes very difficult to separate these cells, especially when you cycle your device. But nonetheless, this is the first chip that was which shipped with the multi-level cell. And you can see that this was 1997. And this window between your zero state and your program state, your erase state and your program state, was around 3 volts. And this corresponded to around 30,000 electrons stored between your program and erase state. This was back in 1997, when the first MLC product shipped. And people were able to store 4 levels in it, and each of them corresponded to around 3,000 electrons. And if you have 3,000 electrons and you want to retain them for 10 years, it means you need to lose less than 300 electrons a year or less than an electron per day. So as you can see, it's already a very stringent requirement, but nonetheless, so I'm not really making this up. This is an actual paper from Samsung. It shows the recent of these memory, and the way this was done was you apply different amount of voltages on your control gate. So if you apply 15 volt, you reach one state. If you apply 16 volt, you need another threshold voltage. And that's the way people used to achieve this multi-level cell operation. So your controller, which is controlling this flash array, now has to generate multiple of these voltages. And that's usually not a very easy thing to do. But look at what's happening in the current technology. So this is the total number of electrons that you store between your program and erase state as a function of different technology nodes. So at 20 nanometer node, you only have around 500 electrons in total between your the lowest threshold voltage state and your highest threshold voltage state. And if you want to store 10 levels or 16 levels into it, what you get is essentially 10 electrons for each of these states. And you want to, if you want to retain them for 10 years, that means you want to lose 1 electron over a year. So it has gone from losing 1 electron per day to losing 1 electron per year. But still, you know, I find it hard to believe, but it's actually people are able to do that. But this is important that, you know, for a 20 nanometer cell, you only store around 500 electrons. And per state, you only have 10 electrons. But this, you know, it comes with certain trade-offs. And since you have these many levels, you significantly degrade the number of times you can cycle your cell or the number of times you can program and erase it. So typically, a NAND flash cell, you can program erase it 10 to power 5 times, or you can program erase it 100k times. So if you have a multi-level cell, you can program and erase it only 10,000 times. Many cases, if it's like a 4-bit per cell, you can only read and write into it less than 1,000 times. Also, retention is much poorer. So it's only 1 year instead of 10 years. It's also slow if you're doing, since you have very bad retention and program erase cycling, you have to add more error correction bits to compensate for it. So this is showing, or some actual data showing, that if you have a single level cell, you can program it 100k times. If you have a multi-level cell, 2-bit per cell, you can program it at only 10K times. If it's actually three level per cell, it's less than 1,000 times. And you also have to add more and more error correction bits. And also it's slow. So all those companies that I showed you earlier, which were working on flash memory storage, what they are trying to do, they're all recipe companies. They take these different amount of some storage here, but a large number of storage here, and even large number of storage in triple level cell, and they come up with algorithms how to achieve an overall system which is faster, but at the same time, it's low in price.